Good evening, participants. I welcome you all the participants to be the part of this webinar today on Shield Connect. And today's webinar is on short and stimulating cases in pediatric practice. And today our moderators, there are two moderators, Dr. Atanu Gadra, and he's a senior pediatric consultant and intensivist and medical superintendent in ESI Hospital, Asansol, in West Bengal. And Dr. Sanjay Niranjan, sir, is a senior consultant, pediatrician in Neo Child Clinic in Lucknow, UP. And our special guest speaker is Dr. K. Radhakrishnan. So, Dr. Atanu will give the brief intro of our speaker. Before I handle the session, let me give you a short intro of our page, Shield Connect. So, you can go to this shieldconnect.in and you can find our page, the digital platform, which is Shield Connect, and you can see various sections available. So whenever you want to attend any webinars, so we have one section, webinars, upcoming webinars and past webinar. So when you click on webinar, you have to just log in through your email ID. And you have to enter your password. And then as you enter into the webinar, you can see all the upcoming webinars which we are doing with all the eminent doctors. So you can go into see more and register and can go through the webinars. Then we have a blog section where you can find all various kinds of blogs written by the eminent doctors on various topics like PCOS, then myo-inositol in male infertility, then role of mutants and COVID. There are many articles available. Then we have two special awareness pages like immune booster page where you can find the reintroduction of our product Revimenu. And then there is PCOS awareness page where you can find all the videos from the doctors in various regional language, Telugu, Malayalam. Then there is one each hour leaders where you can find all the key opinion leaders where all the doctors are connected with this page, Shield Connect, and there is a special page. So where you can find all the webinars or videos related to hypertension day or other days. So like in hypertension, you can see the videos related to hypertension given by eminent doctors. So let's start our session. And delegates, participants, you can post your queries so we can share it with the moderators, and then we can have a Q&A session with our speakers. So I introduce Dr. Atanu Gadra. Sir is a consultant, senior pediatrician and intensivist. And sir has various posts in the past. So let's I hand over the session to Dr. Atanu.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Nishant, sir. Can you please stop sharing, sir? Yeah. So thanks, Shield, for taking this academic initiative and carrying the CMEs across all over India. Today we'll be joining. I'll be joining in from. I have already joined in from Calcutta, and we have a very senior pediatrician, Dr. Sanjay Niranjan, joining in from Lucknow. He's health advocacy and children on child issues, and he's a senior IAPN, both a EB member from 2020 and 2021. He was president and secretary of NNF Lucknow and also IAP Lucknow, and of course my senior friend and philosopher and guide also in the EB, and we will both be moderating this session. and try to give you some scientific inputs which might be useful in your regular practice. So I request Dr. Sanjay Niranjan sir to please take over the screen.
Thank you very much Dr. Atanu sir for so nice introduction. It is my proud privilege really to introduce our speaker for today, Dr. Radhakrishnan. Dr. K. Radhakrishna is undergraduate and postgraduate from Andhra Medical College, Visakhapatnam. He was the best outgoing student of his batch, which is 1975. He had gold medal in the very first year on physiology in 1976, gold medal in pharmacology in 1977, and again gold medal in microbiology in 1978. That was followed by two medals in medicine at 1979. So he was the outgoing student best and he continued this legacy in the PG. He won the gold medal for scoring highest marks in the MD pediatric examination, Venugopal gold medal. And as among his students, he is known as a gifted teacher because he joined the same college for teaching where he taught as assistant professor for 15 years. And for last 20 years, he's running his own. He's MD and chief consultant pediatrician at Omni RK Mother and Child Care. He has represented his state in Central IAP in 2007 and 2017. He was a state president of Andhra Pradesh in 2010. And here, look, he has delivered more than 1,200 lectures in IAP and IMA platforms across the country. So our teachers always said that patient is your best teacher. So he has come up with his vast 35 years of post-PG experience. Hundreds of cases he has got collection. So he has come up with the choice of best 25 for us today. I invite Dr. Radhakrishnan sir to enlighten us on select cases in pediatrics along with neurology.
Yeah.
I will also request the audience to please be on alert mode because it is going to be an interactive session and you can post your questions and feedbacks in the chat box. Thank you.
Good evening, Dr. Atanu, Dr. Sanjay Niranjan, team of SHIELD. My topic, short and stimulating cases, is one of the simplest lecture, but quite fascinating in the sense that when I finished my post-graduation in 1984, I read Nelson and I thought I knew everything. But after starting practice, I came to know that I did not know many small things. Even very recently, I came to know certain fundamentals. I always enjoy what mistakes I have done to tell people. If I have committed a mistake, I tell people so that they learn from my experience. If you learn from your experience, you have to face trouble and learn. But whatever mistake I have committed, if I tell you the story, you will definitely learn. At the same time, you will not face the problem. I'm sure, I'm 100% confident that many of you know the answers, but there would be some who will really benefit from this presentation. We all pediatricians in our country, we have the same problems. We have dull season, we have busy seasons. Everybody, right now we are in extremely dull season. Every pediatrician has the same problems. We are, general pediatrician is not confident in managing in an approach to inborn error of metabolism in a case of immunodeficiency, gait disorders. So these are all the problem, or precocious puberty, or ambiguous genitalia. We are not very confident. Every pediatrician has the same problem. We have the same seasons. Therefore, if I have a doubt, every pediatrician will have the same doubt, or most of them will have a doubt. Whatever cases I've seen and learned, there are many people who might see in the future and therefore they learn. Now, it was the year 1987. I went to a CME at Chennai. The topic was PUO. The speaker said, the first thing we should know is how to position a thermometer. So
he asked us, would you like to put it from the front of the axilla or back of the axilla? Let us, you can answer this question in your mind. Those who vote for one, those who vote from behind, or people, some of you would say, it does not matter, it is from the front or back, or the last answer is none. Okay, answer it in your mind. Well, the answer is none of the above. It's very simple. This is the correct answer. You have to put it from below so that it will not shoot the axilla. Many times we put it like this, it shoots the axilla. So if you do not want the tip of the thermometer not shooting the axilla, it should be from the from below. That I learned from in the second year of practice. After when the beginning of the lecture, when the person who spoke on PUO told me this point, I was so thrilled, because this will never be given in a textbook. Okay. Now, in the last few years, most of us are going for the infrared non-contact thermometers, and it has become very easy. So you need not worry whether it is from the front or back. Now, which of the spellings of vomiting is correct? Vomitings, V-O-M-I-T-T, V-O-M-M, V-O-M-I-T-I-N-G-S, V-O-M-M, V-O-T-T-I-N-G-S. So you can answer in your mind, which is the correct spelling? Well, the answer is none of the above. Now, very frequently, pediatricians, we see our postgraduates presenting, the child had 3 vomitings in the morning, or the child had 4 vomitings in the evening, or the vomitings are increasing. So there is nothing like vomitings. I learned it in the first year of practice, when one of the assistant professor, when I was presenting vomitings, he said, Radhakrishna, there is nothing like vomitings. I was not impressed by what he said. So I went to see all the dictionaries, but I did not get the word vomitings. So students should never present as vomitings. They should say, the child vomited 3, the child vomited 2 times, the child vomited 5 times. Okay, let me. Now, many times we see these cases, parents say the child is fine when not crying and when smiling. But when the child is crying, the face looks like that. The angle of the mouth comes like that, drawn to the right. The mother is upset that there is abnormality in the lip on the right side. Or look at this child. When the child is crying, the lip is getting deviated to the left. So what is this? Definitely not a facial palsy, because the eyelids are not, eyelids are not affected. Then what is it? Now, that is a typical congenital absence of depressor anguli oris muscle. Congenital absence of depressor anguli oris muscle. Now, as far as the angles of the mouth are concerned, they can be pulled up by the levator anguli oris, pulled down by the depressor anguli oris. So you see artists, you know, with a simple stroke, curve downwards, it is a smiling face. With the curve upward, it is a crying face. So when you want to smile, we require the levator anguli oris muscle pulling up both sides. And when you want to have a crying or a weeping face, it should be the DAO, depressor anguli oris muscle. So look at this child. When he's crying, the right is pulled down. Okay. A defect is on which side? Parents think the defect is on the right side in this child, but in reality, it is the left side. The absence of muscle is on the left side. I observe more than a dozen cases a year. Probably I would have seen 200 or 300 cases. Occasionally I see 2 cases a day also. The defect is present approximately 0.5 to 1% of the newborn babies. And some of the intelligent mothers say, doctor, what can I do? We'll tell them only smiling, no crying. If the child does not cry, he will not have that pulled angle of the mouth. Now, I'd seen these cases when I was a house surgeon in the first 4 or 5 years of practice. Look at this case, 25 years primary delivered, a female 3.1 kgs, put to the breast in 2 hours, because IAP always says put to the breast as early as possible, put to the breast as early as possible. So the intelligent mother put to the breast when milk was not coming. She started expressing on the 2nd and 3rd day. And some of the milk she collected in the spoon, to her horror, it was Coca-Cola colored. You can see the test tube, cola colored milk, and it was rather rusty, and significant milk was there in day 3. So when I saw this as a house surgeon, I asked our gynecology madam, what should we do to this milk? Should we throw it? She said, okay, పర్వాలేదు ఇన్ తెలుగు వీసే పర్వాలేదు అంటే ఇట్స్ ఓకే సో డి షీ డి నాట్ గివ్ అన్ ఆన్సర్ అండ్ ది మదర్ కంటిన్యూడ్ ఫీడింగ్ ది మదర్ వాజ్ ఇన్ గుడ్ హెల్త్ దే వాజ్ నో టెండర్నెస్ నో క్రాకెడ్ డింపుల్ వాట్ వాజ్ దిస్ కండిషన్ కోలా కలర్డ్ డిస్కలరేషన్ ఆఫ్ ది మిల్క్ అండ్ ఐ ఆస్ ది మదర్ ఆన్ ది ఎయిత్ డే షీ సెడ్ డాక్టర్ బై సిక్స్ సెవెన్ డేస్ ఇట్ హెస్ కమ్ ఐడ్ సీన్ త్రీ ఫోర్ కేసెస్ ఇన్ మై ఫస్ట్ టెన్ ఇయర్స్ ఆఫ్ ప్రాక్టీస్ Cola colored milk automatically disappearing mother in health condition. Let me ask people how many cases they had seen because the incidence of this condition is 0.5 to 1%. So I'd seen at least half a dozen cases in my lifetime. So this is known as rusty pipe syndrome. Old bungalows, you know, when I was a kid, we used to live in government bungalows where the pipes used to get, the inner part of the pipe used to get rust. First 1 minute, it used to be rusty pipe water. We used to allow the water to float and then wash our face with the fresh water. Now, rusty pipe syndrome is nothing but altered blood-tinged milk, bilateral, but can start unilaterally. No evidence of inflammation, either in the breast or nipple. There is no pain. More common in primates and mothers who have performed nipple exercises. One of the important differential diagnosis would be a rare condition known as duct papilloma. Rarely fibrocystic disease can have this rusty pipe, the blood-tinged milk, or rarely cracked nipples where the condition is very painful. The result is excellent. It automatically improves. See the milk in the cup where it is rusty colored. Breastfeeding need not be stopped. Rusty milk will disappear in a week. Unfortunately, not described. When I told this point to one of my friends and asked him what could be the condition, nobody could answer. I asked so many people, gynecologists, pediatricians, why the milk is rusty in some people. Nobody could answer. Everybody saying it's okay, leave it. And what used to happen was 7 days or 8 days, it used to improve spontaneously. In the 16th year of my practice, my friend said, Radhakrishna, your doubt has been answered. So there was a letter to the editor mentioning about this rusty pipe syndrome. An article was mentioned about the rusty color of the milk, which is a benign condition. But if a pediatrician sees a blood-tinged milk uniformly giving a rusty appearance, he will be horrified. And many times the gynecologist might not answer. Okay, look at this child of 6 years. Brought with a diarrhea of 3 days. The mother was persistent regarding diet. In our country, high priority is given to the diet. So since she was pestering as a source of probiotics, I said, okay, give curd rice. The mother immediately said, doctor, my child refuses curds. Not only refusing curd, if somebody is eating curd, he will vomit here. So he's allergic to curd. So I'd seen these cases almost 5 to 10 years. I asked so many gastroenterologists, pediatricians, why around 1 in 100 or the 2 in 100 of our pediatric cases, they just refuse curd. So there are some children, if curd was put in a glass and the glass was cleaned also, some tinge of that smell also, they cannot tell. So why they are refusing? The gastroenterologist would say, they don't give curd. No, I said, why they are refusing curd? So then finally, I'm sure a lot of people would be there who had seen similar cases. On an average, I see more than 15 cases of children not taking curd. Okay. So what do we call this condition? We call it as selective eaters. We call it as a selective eaters. Now, there are certain children who do not like green foods. Certain children who do not like orange colored. I don't like sticky items. A friend of mine was there in school. He never used to eat a laddu. He used to say, I won't like this laddu because there was cashew in it. He says, when cashew is there, I don't like. So I used to sit by his side because he used to give the laddu to me. Now, I used to have a mother who said, doctor, what is the color of this syrup? I said, it was colorless. I asked her, why you are asking me the color? She said, my child does not like red color. So these people are selective eaters. Their taste buds do not accommodate this particular taste. Their tongue does not like the texture. Their tongue does not, the eyes do not like the color. These are known as selective eaters. Now, many of the parents asked, doctor, what do we do with the selective eaters? Chatur, she said, they are also called sensory food aversions. probably they have different taste buds. Now, what do we do to do these children? Don't force them. Serve very small quantities of that food. Expose the child to the food repeatedly. Routinely, we have to give 5-8 times, they like it. So try 10 times, 20 times, 30 times, small amount. Try leaving the food within the reach without offering or forcing the child. Probably some of the children might improve. Okay, now look at this case. As pediatricians, many of the parents would say, doctor, look at my child, his walking is not nice. So this is a classical case of flat feet. Who doesn't know about flat feet? Most flat feet do not require surgery, can ideally be managed with special footwear, that is orthosis. How many agree, how many disagree? They do not require surgery, but you have that orthosis placed in a boot or a shoe, that's more than adequate. How many agree or disagree? Okay, let me tell you the story. Now, when you get a case of flat foot, what would you do? Take an X-ray, take a MRI, CT, CT foot with contrast, none of the above. Now, one of the good professors, one of our professors, after my 10 years of practice, he was giving a good lecture. So he told us, you will be seeing so many flat foot. What do you do? We said, we'll put an implant below the foot, orthosis, orthodesis, all these things. No. You should never do that. Whenever you get a child with flat foot, what are you supposed to do is ask the child to stand on the toes. Okay. When the child stands on the toes, he will get an arch that is absolutely benign condition. If he does not get that arch on standing on the toes, it is an abnormal condition. So when you stand on the toes with a flat foot child, if you get an arch on standing, you call it as flexible flat foot. If you do not get an arch on standing, you call it as a rigid flat foot. Now, this rigid flat foot, hardly I see once in 5 years or 10 years. So if you get a rigid flat foot, it is not our case. Send it to an orthopedician because you have rare condition. Flexible flat foot is very common. Please remember, flat foot can be common in the first or second year. So if it is persistent beyond 3 years, ask the child to stand on toes. If he gets an arch, just leave it. If he gets an arch on standing, just leave it. If he doesn't get an arch, it is known as rigid, very rare, very, very, very common, flexible flat foot. So until I heard that lecture, for years I used to send, first 10 years of practice, I used to send these cases to a nearby cobbler. So per year, he used to get at least 100 orders from pediatricians. After the pediatrician listened to the lecture, what happened was they stopped sending it to the cobbler. He became very poor. So whenever you get a flat foot, ask him to stand. He gets an arch on standing. He neither requires surgery. He does not require surgery. He does not require any orthosis. Just leave it. So flexible, rigid. Flexible is the rule 99. Rigid is rare. Send it to an orthopedician. Any carcial collation, various conditions are there, rare conditions, they will take care. So many small practical things are not mentioned in books, or if mentioned, we do not grasp it. Listen to a good experienced speaker. So about approach to case of flexible flat foot, it took me almost a decade after starting practice, because until then I used to send to a cobbler for that orthosis. Now look at this case. 16-year female, good-looking adolescent, was advised pre-anesthetic evaluation for inguinal hernia. She was smart. Her anesthetist was worried about an abnormal X-ray and said, we have to postpone because there is some vascular malformation. The adolescent with X-ray was referred to me. So this adolescent X-ray, she had some coiled spring lesion in her chest. So I did not know what it was. Then I asked her to come and sit. I examined this girl, adolescent girl, inspection, palpation, percussion, auscultation. I expected a vascular bruit. Unfortunately, nothing was there. Blood pressure was normal. Chest was normal. No murmurs. Nothing was there. And what is the cause of this coil lesion? I did not understand. Is it a AV malformation in the lung? Is it a AV malformation in the chest? or is it a coarctation of aorta? You can see this was the girl and that was the next ray. So that was the coiled spring, was nothing but her hair coils. So that was a typical artifact. So whenever reading an X-ray, look at the penetration, look at the rotation, look at whether it is a good inspiratory film or a bad expiratory film, motion artifacts, then artifacts like a hair lock which would fall on the X-ray. So that was a typical artifact. Next case. A 7-year-old male child brought for recurrent mild headaches, not disturbing his activities of 6 months. Clinical examination was not rewarding. Before I could do anything, the patient said, "Doctor, the previous pediatrician took a CT because we requested him." And when I looked at the CT, to my horror, I found a small granuloma exactly in the third ventricle. So that was the small granuloma exactly in the third ventricle. It looked beautiful. The child was perfectly nearly asymptomatic, except for mild headaches once in a month. No neurological deficit. And this is the sagittal section. You can see the lesion there. So issues was, is it a neurocysticercosis? Was it a tuberculoma? If neurocysticercosis, can we treat him? Because it was exactly near the third ventricle. And if the cyst gets degenerated by our treatment, he could develop a hydrocephalus, or should give a treatment or not? Third is, if it is a tuberculoma, does he require 1 year treatment, 1.5 year treatment? I was not very sure. So whenever I have a doubt, I make it a point to refer to an intelligent person or the best centers in India. So I send it to an adult neurologist in those days because there was no pediatric neurologist. So I asked him, "What shall we do, sir?" He said, "No anti-cysticercal drug." Okay, fine. "No ATT." Okay, fine. "Sir, what do we do to this granuloma?" He said, "Basically, it is not a granuloma." He said it was a typical choroid cyst of the third ventricle. It's seen in 1 to 2% of intracranial tumors, 20% are intraventricular masses, seen in 0.1% of the population. India, with a population of 130 crore, will have at least 0.1%, means at 13 lakh people with a choroid cyst. Most choroid cysts are found incidentally or accidentally. Rarely they will require surgery. Okay, these are worms and drugs. A 4-year-old male child was brought with a diarrhea of 4 days, but improved. Then why did the mother come? "Doctor, I came not for the diarrhea." When the child had diarrhea, the child passed 100 to 150 threadworms and 3 roundworms. We are worried that there'll be thousands of threadworms and hundreds of worms because he just passed a sample. Then since the parents said they were worms, I immediately advised mebendazole for 3 days. Now, parents are very, very intelligent. They observe what we do. So next day morning, they collected the motion sample, absolutely no worm. They were absolutely unhappy. They came back to me, "Doctor, not even one worm the child passed." So what could have happened? Were all the worms flushed out during diarrhea, or the medicine did not work? I did not know for a long time. So then finally, we got the answer. Now, when we give mebendazole and albendazole, this modern days, last 20, 25 years, we are giving these wonderful drugs. When I was a postgraduate, we had only pyrantel and piperazine. When we were giving pyrantel and piperazine, we used to see tons of worms coming out. Now, a worm in the intestine survives because it secretes anti-enzymes from the cuticle. Piperazine and pyrantel paralyze the worm. They do not kill the worm. The cuticle is still active. Anti-enzymes are there. So it is only paralyzed and it comes out. This modern mebendazole and albendazole will kill the worm within half an hour, 1 hour or 2 hours, the worm is digested. So first 5 or 10 years of my practice, especially after mebendazole was introduced around 30 years, for 4 or 5 years, none of the parents were happy. They used to say, "Doctor, not even one more." I asked my colleagues, "How mebendazole is working, they used to say it is absolutely trash. I have never seen any parent saying the child passed over. So the basis is when you give albendazole, they kill the worm, it is digested. Now, from that day, last 25 years, after I came to know, I've been always telling to the parents that how many of you tell your patient's parents that they will not expect any worms in the stool after using albendazole? You answer to yourself. Most of the people, they say, I never told. There are exceptional people who always tell. So when I prescribe albendazole, it is my responsibility to tell the parents, for heaven's sake, don't expect any worms to come out in the motion life. All the worms will die and they will digest. Now, many times we see children who have got a space between the incisors. Now, what do we call it? Space between the two incisors? Diastema. So when you get a case of diastema, space between the two teeth, what will you do? Avert the lip and look for a thick freedom. Avert the lip and look for a thick freedom. Look for hypothalamic lesion. Look for pituitary lesion. Take a history of injury to the teeth. The answer is avert the lip and look for the thick frenum. Now, many of the times diastema can be associated with a thick frenum. This is the normal frenum. So what is the advice when you have a thick frenum? I learned it after 10 years of practice when a dentist said, when you get a diastema, for heaven's sake, please refer between the ages of 5 and 10 years, because they will do something. Once the permanent incisors have come, they do a surgery if it is a thick frenum. Now, name a famous personality who has got a diastema. Eddie Murphy. Okay. Now, I've seen so many cases when I said to the parent, father, see, your child has a big space between the teeth. Please take to a dentist. Then he used to open his mouth and tap his mouth like that. So then he said, doctor, that is our family sign. My father has it. I have it. My son has it. It's not abnormal. He thought everybody has it. If somebody has six fingers, all the family, they think that is normal. So I told, this is correctable. And I sent to a dentist. Probably the thick frenum is a genetic trait. Now, many times we see permanent incisors erupting behind the temporary. So this is the temporary. This is the permanent. Now, you can identify permanent by the serrations. Permanent incisors have that serrations. With time, it becomes smooth after 1 or 2 years. This is known as a mamelon. The permanent incisor is formed from 3 mamelons. So you get that serration. When you get this situation, do we remove the temporary? Do we remove the permanent teeth? Remove both of them. Wait for the temporary teeth to form. My answer for many years after starting practice was, wait till temporary to fall off naturally. That should is the wrong answer. Remove the temporary. Remove the temporary, because the permanent can sit in the place. So removal of temporary is recommended when you see permanent teeth erupting. If you do not do that, you will have crooked tooth. Now, this was a point case I learned after 6 months of practice, because the parents are really intelligent. 9-month infant, mother said, doctor, for the last 1 week, my child is passing black worms which are dead in the motion. They look like threads, non-motile. So since the mother herself said black threads, I said use mebendazole. Then after mebendazole, parents are really brilliant, you know. They said, doctor, after 3 days of mebendazole, the worms have not decreased. Then she herself said, shall we get a motion test? I did not get any answer. Then what is this diagnosis? Many of the parents, you are not intelligent, you know. She was not convinced that I'd understood. She brought a sample of motion to me to the clinic. So there were small filamentous black worms which were not moving. I did not know the answer for a long time. But in a period of 6 months, you know, 3 mothers said, doctor, this back 9 months, 8 months, 10 months, black worm, some of them used to get it in this matchbox. So what happened was, one of the brilliant mothers said, she gave me the answer. Whenever I give banana, I get this black worms. In a CME, where pediatricians from all India came. When I asked this question, people from Kerala answered within a second. So if a child is banana, you have that black threads in the motion, which is an absolutely benign condition. Now, what is this syndrome? This child has a mongoloid gland, depressed nasal bridge, delayed milestones, likes music, small head, large, relatively large tongue. So this was a case of classical Down syndrome. Will you agree that it is Down syndrome, right or wrong? You have seen the child. Is it Down syndrome or not? Answer is, it is not Down syndrome. For at least 13 years of practice, I used to write it as Down syndrome. One of my students said, sir, you cannot call it as Down syndrome. It is only Down syndrome. I verified so many books. Finally, I could not get any answer. The answer was Down syndrome, Down syndrome, Downs. We have added that S. So we have a habit of adding S. Turner syndromes, Klinefelter syndrome. The answer is Klinefelter. Apert syndrome, actually Apert. Noonan syndrome, actually Noonan. Okay, look at this Potter. For the first 10 years of my practice or 5 years of practice, whenever a child with a ring lesion around the anus used to come, I used to make a diagnosis of perianal candidiasis. So what is it? It's not perianal candidiasis. If you take a chance, is it seborrheic, perianal candidiasis, diaperdermatitis, perianal infectious dermatitis? The answer is perianal infectious dermatitis, seen between the ages of 6 months and 10 years. Rash is superficial erythematous, well marginated. Pruritus is very common. A white pseudomembrane can form. As the rash becomes more chronic, it becomes painful. The cause is by group A beta hemolytic streptococcus. They respond to mupirocin. First 5 to 10 years of practice, I was advising candid ointment. So that is perianal infectious dermatitis. This is the classical perianal candidiasis, where you see the satellite lesions. Candidiasis, you have to see that satellite lesion. A six-year-old male child wasting left half of the chest. You can see the wasting left half of chest. Recurrent cold and cough once in 3 months. Height and weight nearly normal. Lower limit of normal, 10th percentile. Examination of CVS. Lungs, everything was normal. I did not understand why. On auscultation also, it was the breath sounds were heard very well. I did not know what was the cause. Then parents said, doctor, we'll take an x-ray chest. So we took an x-ray. To my surprise, I found a normal x-ray in this chest. Look at the left and right half. They were normal. Why this disparity clinical in and the x-ray when breath sounds were heard well on the left side? Well, the answer is very simple. I see, how many of you see these cases? In my lifetime, I've seen at least a dozen of cases. And the answer is congenital absence of pectoralis major. This is the pectoralis major, sternal head, clavicular head. So when this sternal head is absent, you get a relative atrophy. 1971, I was 13 years. I was in seventh class. We had gone to an excursion to Chennai. I was sitting in the second row of the bus. One of the Tamilian person who was sitting by me was looking at me, giving me a smile, and he was making funny sounds like this. He was making sounds. So when he was making these sounds, I was a little worried. I shifted from that place. I did not know what was the cause. Why is he making that sound? He was making sounds, throaty sounds, and I shifted from this place. I did not know the answer. I got the answer after 40 years when I was going for the morning walk with an ENT person. He said, I'm sure many of you would have seen these cases. He said, whenever you have itching of the palate, you make those sounds. So in allergic rhinitis, you have nasal symptoms, non-nasal symptoms, and itching of the palate. Since you cannot scratch your palate, you make that sounds. Okay. For the first 5-10 years of practice, I used to see a lot of mothers saying, doctor, my child will not sit in the Indian cross leg position. She is very comfortable in W. When I ask her to sit in the Indian cross leg, matam we say in Telugu, they don't like, she'll sit only in W. So I did not know for quite a long time. It took me almost 15 years of practice. Somebody I learned in a conference that it was persistent femoral antiversion. that is the position they sit because of internal rotation of the limb. If it is mild, it improves spontaneously. It took me almost 24 years of practice to know what is persistent femoral antiversion because they sit. Now, this is the normal angulation. In persistent femoral antiversion, the angulation of the head of femur is a little more. So natural protection mechanism is internal rotation. So they walk with intoeing. Okay. Now this was when I was a house surgeon in 1979. It was a five-year-old male, Master Satish, playing with the knee hammer after the carpenters left the house, and he developed a black nail. That was at 4 hours. What do you do? Now, 79, I was hearing a lecture from a plastic surgeon. He said, here, there's a group of doctors who are mixed, house surgeons, postgraduate, assistant professors. Even though he was a plastic surgeon, I'll tell you a small treatment for such cases because you see it day in and day out. So his main lecture was how to re-implant the cut limb. If the limb was cut from the body, how to connect back the limb. That was his lecture. But as general doctors, you may not be interested in that. And he suggested, when you get a black nail, what do you do? Most of us, we say, just leave it. So answer is not leave it alone. If you leave it, what happens is, in a matter of 24 hours, it becomes a full black nail. The nail will be separated from the bud, from the nail bed, by that small drop of blood, and it will die after a few days, and it will get fallen off. So when you get a small black nail because of a hemorrhage, let out the blood with a needle, take a routine needle, give a prick, you will get a small drop of blood, but the black nail will stop spreading. 1980, I was a house surgeon. There was a wonderful ophthalmologist, Sur Narayan Murthy. I was a house surgeon following the rounds, and they have performed a cataract surgery, and this professor said to his assistant professor, hey, see that the fellow doesn't sneeze, because there'll be raised intraocular pressure. That assistant said, sir, what do I do to prevent sneezing? Shall I block his nose? This person said, you can stop sneezing. This assistant professor said, how do I stop sneezing? And he told me how to stop a sneezing. I was thrilled how we could stop a sneezing. Because many times when we are eating, you want to postpone by 1 or 2 minutes. You are with a super VIP, you want to stop sneezing for a few minutes. When you are in a procedure, you want to stop sneezing. I've tried it hundreds of times. The sneezing, it can stop. How do you stop it? Just press the upper lip. Yes, wonderful. Just press the upper lip or press the upper lip like this. The sneezing will stop immediately, but it will come back after a minute or two. By that time, important things would have been finished. So I was so thrilled when our professor told 41 years ago how to stop sneezing by simple procedure. There's so many people, when I say this, how will it work? No, it works wonders. Okay, a 2-year-old female child was brought by their panicky parents saying that their sweet little daughter's vaginal opening has disappeared. Now, many of the grandparents, you know, they're very brilliant. At birth, they see all the orifices, eyes, nose, mouth. And she has also observed that the vaginal opening was there. She was so upset when the vaginal opening has disappeared. So the family came running to me. And when I saw the condition, I was also thrilled. When for the first time I had seen this condition, I did not know what it was. So what is this condition where a vaginal opening disappears, seen in 1% of the children? Labial fusion. It's not an uncommon condition seen in 1%. Partial or complete adhesion of the labia minora. The fusion is usually in the middle and appears as a thin pale streak. I showed you that is the thin pale streak. Seen between the ages of 3 months and 5 years. Peak incidence in 1 to 2%. Corresponds with the lowest level of estrogen. Most commonly, it is inflammation from vulvovaginitis. So labial fusion is because of recurrent vulvovaginitis. At this age, before puberty, the levels of estrogen are low, and therefore they're very prone for vulvovaginitis. So once they get a vulvovaginitis, the labia minora can fuse like that. Okay, can fuse like that. can fuse like that. So majority are asymptomatic, found accidentally, occasionally cause obstruction to the stream of urine or post-viral dripping. They respond dramatically by application of estrogen cream once or twice a day for 1 or 3 months. Very early in practice, I used to apply, I advise ointment for 1 or 2 days. They were not separating. We used to send for manual separation under general anesthesia, which is wrong. Majority, 99% of the labial fusions, they respond by estrogen. You rarely require manual separation. First 5 years of practice, so many parents were bringing, doctor, what was this lesion? It is small swelling on the penis. So I asked them, painful? No, everything was fine. The swelling was there. So this child was apparexial, single swelling. On palpation, it was putty-like consistency. It was not tender. Child did not offer any resistance. He also had a phimosis. So I'd seen half a dozen cases in the first 4 or 5 years of practice. So finally, when I had a child, I took the child to a pediatric surgeon. And then he said, it is absolutely benign condition, which you call it as a smegma pearl. When you have phimosis, the underlying debris will accumulate like this. It is putty in consistency, which you call it as a smegma pearl. Correct the phimosis, he improves. Umpteen number of children who have constipation, you ask them, do you have a tag of skin around the anus? They respond, yes, that tag of skin in constipation. So what do you call the tag of skin in constipation? Because most of the children with constipation can have a fissure and also a tag. You call it as a sentinel pile. So a sentinel pile is very common because of fissure in anus in a constipation. Last 10 minutes, 42-year-old Suresh came panicky with a history that whenever his only daughter aged 1 year passes urine, black ants, which are plenty in his house, are attracted. Since he was an artist, I asked him, draw the image and get it to me. He drew the image and got it to me. He was upset. He said his father became diabetic at 50. He became a diabetic 1 year ago. Now my child of hardly 1 or 2 years has become a diabetic. He was so unhappy. So we did a urine sugar, RBS normal, repeated urine test thrice normal, all routine investigations were normal. So what could be the cause of ants getting attracted? The only thing as a student I learned was when somebody has a diabetes, urine will attract ants. Now I got the answer from a nephrologist. I asked him, sir, when urine doesn't have sugar, why do ants get? He said, ants get attracted to the small amount of protein. So umpteen number of times we see when there's urine in the house, ants in the house, they get attracted. It is not for the sugar alone. So ants get attracted to the urine who has diabetes and a normal urine also. There should be ants in the house. There should be urine in the house. Okay. Many times we see these children, 12-year-old child, very brilliant, who was getting first mark. Now, unhappy that she's not getting first mark because look at her wet hands. The papers are becoming wet. She has to take 10 or 15 handkerchiefs. In spite of it, she sweats a lot from the hand doctor. Her paper is becoming moist. What is this condition? Hyperhidrosis, palms and sole, seen in either sexes, starts in childhood, very frequently family history, can be part of various syndromes, very frequently associated with hyperhidrosis in the axilla and groins. I'll show you. Tendency to improve by 25 years. What can we do about this case? Look at this child who has a hyperhidrosis. If the axilla, very commonly we see certain women whose jackets, axilla becomes wet. You ask these people, do you have wet hands? They will say yes. So what do we do? First 10 or 15 years of practice, I had to purchase aluminium chloride hexahydrate form, 20 grams. We used to weigh and add to 100 ml of alcohol or 100 grams to 500 ml of alcohol. So nowadays, last one decade, we have this wonderful item. You apply this on the palms of this fellow, put on a bandage at the night so that the bed sheet will not get spoiled. If you apply for 3-4 days, it will work for 3-4 days. So just before examinations or important functions, the child can apply this aluminium chloride 20% hexahydrate form in alcohol. Okay, 10-month infant, whenever he passes urine, it dries like that. Don't get worried. It is because of the phosphates. Now, this child has scanty, discolored, poor-growing, friable hair. This child, mother says, I can never comb her hair. These children downloads, then hair is either woolly, silky, thin, friable. So what is this condition? The broad heading for this condition is hair shaft anomalies. Hair shaft anomalies are very common. You have a big chapter in dermatology. Okay, look at the hair, scanty, friable, twisting. So there are hundreds of hair shaft anomalies. A trichologist can make a diagnosis. Even there will be hair pathologists. Now look at this child who has got 3 testicular swellings and this lesion is translucent. And see, 1, 2, and 3, it's not 3 testes, it's a hydrocele of the cord. Hydrocele of the cord is because of the processes vaginal closing the top as well as the bottom. Now this is the last case before I end. 7-year-old male Akash brought by his intelligent mother saying the child had 2 episodes of seizure. First episode was in the evening. Second episode was while the child was sleeping. Because of the seizure, he was kicking the younger one. The younger one started crying. And then the mother observed the child Akash was having a seizure. She was terrified. The child was examined by a pediatrician, done all the investigations. The child was started on CBZ because he had 2 seizures. The mother said the seizures are not improving and the child was getting jerking of 1 or more limbs. I asked her, what exactly are the seizures? She said the child was jerking whenever in sleep 3-4 times a day. Now, once the child had the seizure in sleep, both the parents started looking at the child continuously 24 hours. By rotation. So many of us have this abnormal myoclonic jerk, normal myoclonic jerks in sleep. I have this myoclonic jerks in sleep. So the pediatrician did not understand when the mother said the mother had jerks in sleep. Actually, they were a benign condition known as sleep myoclonus. The sleep myoclonus is a benign condition. You can have only a jerk of the limb or myoclonus of the body, which does not require any treatment. These are all the cases which I started learning only after I passed my post-graduation. Many of them are neither given in books nor told by anybody. I always enjoy sharing these cases with everybody. They may not, all these may not be new to all of you, but some of them may be very useful to you. Thank you one and all for your patient hearing.
Excellent, sir, presentation, excellent collection of cases. Fortunately, I have seen a couple of cases in a couple of days, and I got few answers. That perianal excoriation, which is bacterial rather than fungal, I just saw a case yesterday only. And there are so many things which I had seen, and so many things which I had never seen. So one of my questions to you, sir, before I invite Dr. Atanu Bhadra, you ask the child with their flat feet to stand on toes. At what age you can do this?
3 years plus.
And for 3 years we can wait. Dr. Yeah. Atanu, sir.
Yeah, these were very apparently very simple, but plenty of knowledge and fundamentals goes into this. And what Radha Krishna sir had done today had put them into our head, and we will never forget about this. So I'm thankful to all the delegates who had joined in. They had a beautiful inputs from the scientific part, because when you were in the office practice, you don't time to refer every time to knowledge which is in the books or in the media. You at that time only the brain is with us, and when Dr. Radha Krishna, teacher like Dr. Radha Krishna around, I think we can reaffirm that our brain is loaded with useful knowledge and not just only academics. I'll request, I don't see any questions in the chat box. In fact, I was so glued to it.
Sir, will transfer the questions.
Yeah.
I think they might be seeing.
Right. Dishant, if you have any questions.
I've got a couple of answers today for W. That the W sitting was also, I could answer. I am sure many of the answers are not in the books. And these are the questions. The parents about the worms, why they are not passing worms, after that answers are not in the books, why they are sitting like W, I don't know, I have not come across the answer, or I have not looked for it. So I have came to know very practical things, that we can answer the question of mothers, which we thought they are silly questions, but mothers are always right. It is we who sometimes are not aware of those conditions.
Yeah, Dr. Ashish Bishra sir, well, welcome to the presentation. And he has said that it was an excellent presentation. Well, Dr. Radhakrishna, Dr. Ashish sir has joined from UP. Sanjay ji?
Yes,
Kanpur,
yes.
I think.
Sir, he is a very dynamic secretary of Kanpur branch of IAP.
Right.
And he is being one of the best branches of the country for past several years, I would say for a decade. It is being awarded one of the best branches of the country, Kanpur IAP. So Ashish Vishwas is the secretary of that.
Well, Ashish sir, thanks for attending this presentation. Dr. Ramakrishna Paramahansa, he has also said that it has been a very useful and practical. Well, we have a question here. What should we do for toe correction?
What should be now? I mean, toe correction. If somebody has a flat foot, just leave it. If it is flexible flat foot, if it is a rigid flat foot, which is uncommon, it has to be sent to a orthopedician. Now, toe correction means when a child walks, they can have in-toeing or out-toeing. You have a variety of causes for in-toeing gait, out-toeing gait, depending upon the case we have to do. So Niranjan was asking, how early can we ask a child to look for the arch? It should be beyond 3 years, sir. Most children in the first year have a flat foot, second year they have a flat foot, and once they start walking, by third year they get a good arch. So wait till 3 years minimum, and you can't ask a child below 3 years to stand on the toes also. So he has to be at least 4 or 5 years. I was very much impressed when our professor said, when you get a flat foot, what do you do? We did not answer, do you want an x-ray? We said we wanted an x-ray. That was already my 8th or 10th year of practice. Then he gave the simple advice, standing on the toes. Then after he has said that, when I referred books, I got the answer. But routinely, when you refer a flat foot, when you read flat foot, you will never get an answer until somebody like him tells us.
From toes, well, this question comes to my mind. As you have wonderfully taught the treatment of the traumatic, that black toenail.
So
what is the differential diagnosis for black nail, sir? Can it be fungal infection or some other?
This is the condition I'm talking about, the acute black nail. When you get a black nail, somebody has an injury, a stone falling on the toe, or a hammer hitting, you get a injury. Many of the times parents come to us within the first 3-4 hours. So there is a very small part of the nail affected by the blood. There is a bleed subungually. There is absolutely no space. So the blood may be just one drop, it spreads. So the plastic surgeon 40 years ago said, take a small needle, just go through the black part, the blood comes out, and then there will be no spread. The one you are asking, the dark nail, you have got a big differential diagnosis. Those are all chronic conditions. Fungal nails, days and weeks. Or trachonychia, days and weeks. So here I'm talking about acute black nail because of injury.
Dr. Mohammed Anas had asked the question of the toe question.
Yeah.
And there are congratulatory messages from Dr. Hazarathia, Dr. M.M. Agarwal. I think we have, we can, Sanjay, I will ask Dr. Sanjay to say a vote of thanks and hand over the...
Sir, can I ask a silly question, sir?
Yes, sir.
if you tell the parents that the worms are killed and digested, the vegetarians may object, sir.
Yeah. Okay, what we will do is they will get killed and disappear.
Okay, so I will ask.
Thank you very much, Shield, the sponsors, and Dr. Radhakrishnan, Dr. Atanu Bhadra for inviting me and sharing the vast experience of 35 years with select cases. But I will here request again, sir, you might be having hundreds of cases from this experience. Many of us got answers to the unanswered questions of the mothers. So please plan the next session very soon. We would like to have more cases, spot cases from you, because these things are not written in books. These you might have earned in the practice only, I'm sure. Might have not been coming across to you during your teaching or student life. They might be in your practice only, sir. Thank you very much.
I got a big album on dermatology. How I learned dermatology was at least 500 times as a postgraduate and an assistant professor. I used to take the child on my scooter to the Department of Dermatology. Then I mastered dermatology. It is a fascinating album because nobody would have taken so many times to the dermatologist as a student, as a postgraduate, then again as an assistant professor. I used to take the child on my scooter, take to the assistant professor, sir, what is this condition? Because dermatology is only seeing rather than talking. So then I mastered the branch of dermatology, pediatric dermatology.
Thank you so much, sir.
Sir, before we conclude the session, sir, thank you very much for that wonderful session, Dr. Radhakrishnan, supported by our moderators. We have a small audio visual of one of our brands, Rudimin Mew. So please, with all of your permission, can we play on to that, sir? Chitrakala, can you play that?
Healthcare, transforming health with innovation and technology, is the winner of the prestigious Indian Health and Wellness Award. Likes to thank you for helping us achieve through your valuable partnership. Health issues like recurrent respiratory infections can cause complex physiological and biochemical changes leading to ambulatory condition. Therefore, we need a specific immune booster to strengthen the respiratory immunity. So, introducing Rudimin Mew tablets and Rudimin Mew syrup to strengthen the respiratory immunity. Rudimin Mew tablets and syrup are a specific combination of four bioactive ingredients along with immunovitamins and minerals. The bioactive ingredients are tenocoridin, curcuminoids, acimenin, osimum sanctum. Rudimin Mew is also enriched with immunovitamins like vitamin A, vitamin C, vitamin D3, and minerals like zinc and selenium. As per ESPN guidelines, May 20, daily allowance of vitamins, minerals, and trace elements maximizes nutritional defense for patients susceptible to frequent respiratory infections. Therefore, please prescribe Rudimin Mew tablets for respiratory infections only. Rudimin Mew strengthen the respiratory immunity. Dose of Rudimin Mew tablet is 1 tablet BID. Dose of Rudimin Mew syrup is 5 ml BID. Doctor, Rudimin Mew shields immunity. Thank you.
So much for watching this video, and thank you so much, sir, Dr. Radhakrishnan. All the participants were saying like kudos to Professor Radhakrishnan, sir. It was an amazing session, and we can see that there were very interesting cases in this webinar, and it was very wonderful talk. So we can conclude this session. And thank you so much, Dr. Sanjay and Dr. Ratanubhadra, for moderating this session. And I also thanks to all the participants to join this webinar. And I also thank to our team members from the Shield who made this webinar possible for Dr. Radhakrishna. And we will glad to have more sessions on this page with you, sir. Thank you.
Atanu, thank you. Sanjay, thank you. Thank you, Shield.
Thank you, sir. So nice of you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you once again, sir. All of you. Thank you so much. And wish you a good evening. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.